Ladies and gentlemen, good day and welcome to the Q2 FY22 conference call of Shemaro Entertainment Limited, hosted by Valorem Advisors. As a reminder, all participant lines will be in the listen-only mode, and there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions after the presentation concludes. Should you need assistance during the conference call, please signal an operator by pressing star then zero on your touchtone phone. I now hand the conference over to Mr. Anuj Sonpal, CEO at Valorem Advisors. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone, and a very warm welcome to you all. My name is Anuj Sonpal from Valorem Advisors. We represent the investor relations of Shemaro Entertainment Limited. On behalf of the company, I would like to thank you all for participating in the company's earnings conference call for the second quarter of the financial year 2022. Before we begin, I'd like to mention a short cautionary statement. Some of the statements made in today's con call may be forward-looking in nature. Such forward-looking statements are subject to risks and uncertainties, which could cause actual results to differ from those anticipated. Such statements are based on management's beliefs as well as assumptions made by and information currently available to management. Audiences are cautioned not to place any undue reliance on these forward-looking statements in making any investment decisions. The purpose of today's earnings call is purely to educate and bring awareness about the company's fundamental business and financial quarter under review. Let me now introduce the management participating with us in today's earnings call. We have with us Mr. Hiren Gada, CEO and Chief Financial Officer, Mrs. Kranti Gada, Chief Operating Officer, and Mr. Amit Harya, Vice President of Finance. Without any further delay, I request Mr. Hiren Gada to give his opening remarks. Thank you, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Anuj, and good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to welcome you to the earnings conference call for the second quarter and first half of financial year FY 2022. I hope everyone is keeping safe and well. Let me start by giving you the key financial highlights. For the second quarter ended September 2021. For the second quarter ended of financial 2022, the operational income stood at 123 crore. EBITDA for the quarter was approximately 10.2 crore as against 7.1 crore in the previous quarter. EBITDA margin stood at 8.29%, and net profit was reported at 2.7 crore with a PAT margin of 2.21%. For the first half of FY 2022, the operating income was 198 crore. EBITDA reported was at 17.3 crore, and EBITDA margin stood at 8.76 crore, while net profit was at 1.4 crore with a PAT margin of 0.69%. In the past quarters, our profitability took a hit primarily due to lower ad spend, muted buying by broadcasters, and our ongoing investment in new initiatives. As is evident from the financial results, I'm happy to share that we are back in the green in terms of profitability in Q2 and also for H1, boosted by a significant growth in the traditional media revenues, which was inevitable as we had been discussing in the past. As most of you are aware, the company has been in an investment mode in the various new initiatives. Hence, it is important to note the expenses made on these new initiatives net of revenue for the periods under review. For Q2 FY 2022, expenses on the new initiatives net of revenue were 16 crore, and for H1 FY 2022, it was 32.5 crore. If you were to adjust for these investments in the new initiatives, the adjusted EBITDA from existing operations would be approximately 26 crore for Q2 FY 2022, and for the half year ended FY 2022, the adjusted EBITDA would be approximately 50 crore. For the second quarter, digital media revenue stood at 47 crore, which were up 21% year-on-year. For the first half, the digital media stood at 87 crore, which is up 20% on a year-on-year basis. Traditional media revenues in the second quarter stood at 76 crore, which is up by 270% year-on-year. For H1 of FY 2022, the traditional media revenue stood at 110 crore, which is up by 52% on a year-on-year basis. On the business side, as consumer and business sentiments across sector continued to improve during the quarter. There was a cautious revival in demand from broadcasters, resulting in an increase in top line for the company. The company's endeavor to transition from a B2B to B2C company. In that same endeavor, we are increasing our focus on creating and strengthening the brand connect across our broadcasting channels and digital businesses such as Shemarumi and Shemaru channels on YouTube. We also released 16 new titles during the quarter on Shemarumi Gujarati with content across movies, web series and plays. Some marquee titles that were released included theatrical blockbusters such as Shuthayu and Chasni. We also released our original web series Puri Pani on our Shemarumi OTT platform, which has been well received by the audiences. On YouTube, we crossed 55 million subscribers on our YouTube channel Filmi Gaane. The channel continues to maintain its foothold as the 21st most subscribed channel in the world. On the broadcasting front, the gradual unlocking of states and increase in out-of-home mobility affected the overall television viewership. In fact, it has affected the overall media viewership, entertainment consumption. This had an impact on the ratings of Marathi movie genre, including Marathi Bana. However, on the positive side, programming changes and investments in marketing expanded our Shemaru TV's reach during the quarter, which has given a boost to the channel's rating. To conclude, with the aggressive vaccination drive, most of the world, including India, is returning to normal, and we are witnessing a significant revival across all our businesses as well. In conclusion, I would say that we are cautiously optimistic that in FY22, the company's performance will show a revival. With that, I open the floor for questions.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, we will now begin with the question and answer session. Anyone wishing to ask a question may please press star and one on your touchtone telephone. If you wish to remove yourself from the question queue, you may press star and two. Participants are requested to use handsets while asking a question. Ladies and gentlemen, we will wait for a moment while the question queue assembles. The first question is from the line of Viraj Mehta from Equitas PMS. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon, Hiren, and great to see us doing so well again. I have a few questions.
Yeah.
First, if I look at our expenditure side, in spite of seeing a significant growth in revenue of almost 48 odd crores on a sequential basis, and our investments in new initiatives remaining same on sequential basis, our cost has gone up significantly apart from the new initiatives. Can you throw some light? Where has this money gone?
Primarily, consumption of the inventory for the traditional media sales. So, the channel sales that we would have done, the content, underlying content cost would have been charged to the P&L.
Okay. But that should have meant your inventory should have also gone down to that extent, which it hasn't. It has gone down only some 20 odd crores.
Correct. So,
for the half year only. Entire half year.
Yeah.
I'll probably connect to your finance team to understand this bit in a little more detail. Is that okay?
Yeah, sure.
The second part, I wanted to understand, if I look at the digital media growth of around 20% for the half year and even for this quarter, can you split that a little bit more into how much has YouTube and how much has other businesses grown?
While I cannot give the growth rates per se, but broadly I would say that the overall share of each of our different revenue contributors has broadly remained the same. So just to recap, as we have shared in the past also, is that YouTube is approximately 50-60% of the top line now. Telco business is is less than about, you can say, 10-ish%, and the remaining comes from combination of syndication and Shemarumi. And that share, which in the past has actually been, if we see a few years back, YouTube was probably less than 30%. So YouTube has obviously, expanded significantly. Of course, it has also come at the cost of the telco business shrinking significantly. So that contribution share has been changing, but this quarter we haven't seen any significant movement on that. So that's broadly remained on similar lines.
Right. The third thing I wanted to understand is, if I look at the business as such, I mean, if we have this growth in digital, which essentially is a very low, reasonably high operating leverage business. And in spite of seeing reasonable growth in top line, we aren't seeing that operating leverage playing out. In your assessment, at 120, 130 crore, if we are not seeing, what is that number post which we'll start seeing the operating leverage play out for us?
The operating leverage is also, so one important thing to keep in mind is the where is the focus of the investment and capital allocation that is going. There is a clear focus on building the B2C businesses out and investing in the B2C business. Now, those businesses are yet to see the positive cash flow, because once that those things start, then the operating leverage definitely could kick in. But there is some time away from that point of view. Otherwise, so the whole idea, and this is something we have been discussing for last few calls or last few quarters, that the focus of the company's investment is in the B2C opportunities and the B2C business.
Sure. Right. Also, what I wanted to understand is, if we look at, I was talking more about the operating leverage excluding the new investments, because our new investments are roughly similar at 15, 16 crore loss a quarter. I mean, for last 3-4 quarters, if I look at it. So,
but no, see, one is you are looking at it only from a top line point of view. I would look at it also from the capital allocation point of view, because I could invest in the older business model of B2B and achieve a certain level of operating leverage by doing that. But I've chosen not to do that and go the B2C route, and therefore there is the turnover of that capital is to that extent limited.
Understood. And as far as, if you can throw some light on how is our syndication business doing, are we seeing, like, traditional media now seems to be picking up, we are seeing green shoots. I wanted to understand, is that growth path continuing? Second, will we see Marathi Bana breaking even sometime later this year by Q4? Those are the two last questions.
Okay, so to answer your first question, yes, this quarter we have seen some amount of cautious of buying, I would say, from broadcasters. That we are hoping, it's too early still to talk about how it will play out over the next couple of quarters, and definitely the overall advertiser sentiment has improved. It's still not back to pre-COVID level. Still, there are quite a few segments which are under the weather, to that extent, the broadcasters are cautious. What I would currently rate some of the business to be more pent-up demand in terms of certain library or content getting expired and needs replenishment, or certain, you know, refresh of library that is needed. That is more the thing. I wouldn't say that it is still a full-fledged, you know, back to normal kind of a level. But as I said, it's too early. You know, we have 5 months or up to 5 months remaining for the rest of the year. So I don't know how this will play out on the broadcasters buying side. On Marathi Bana, I would at this point actually refrain from giving any indication on when we expect it to break even. I would, however, give a couple of, and I'll also tell you why, because, you know, the situation has been quite dynamic. As I said earlier, we've really not had what we could call a normal quarter or a normal period. It's, you know, we've been living in abnormal periods, and therefore fluctuation. During the lockdown, the viewership shoots up significantly, but advertising drops. In the unlockdown, you know, viewership drops. Advertising probably lags behind because the business confidence may not still be fully back, or all sectors may not be fully back. So considering all of that, we have kind of in that kind of a period. So while we have a definite plan of how we want to take it forward in place, but to pinpoint right now, I would refrain from that. I know in the past I have discussed this, but unfortunately the whole COVID-led situation has played out differently from what everyone probably had anticipated two, three quarters back. Another thing I would add overall is that we have a definite, content and programming and overall strategy in place. Kranti, you want to talk a little more about that?
So I would say that Marathi Bana has gained considerable mind share amongst the Marathi movie audience. We are in the consideration set, which is, for a young brand, we think it's in the right direction. And in the last 3 to 4 months, and you may already be, if you watch the channel, you'll notice we've invested a lot on disruptive programming. We've been doing a lot of innovation on the programming to help, set a loyal audience and definitive identity for the channel. And, I would just say that you can maybe just visit the channel even now, and, I'm sure you'll see exactly understand what I mean. So there is while revenues are playing out, we also see an opportunity to define the identity and, get a strong mind space in the consumer's mind.
Which lays a strong foundation overall for the.
Sure. Thanks a lot for detailed explanation and good luck.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, in order to ensure that the management is able to address questions from all participants in this conference, we request you to limit your questions to 2 per participant only. The next question is on the line of Shikha Mehta from Equitree Capital. Please go ahead.
Hello, sir. I just have a couple of questions.
Yeah.
So our traditional business has grown significantly this quarter, but we haven't seen much inventory reduction. So could you give some color on that, or when we will see inventory turnover levels touch 1 or go below 1?
Actually, the inventory has come off. I don't know why. If we see in March, if we see year on year, we've come off by, almost 35 crores on the inventory. And even if we see from March, it's down by 20 crores. So
do we see this reduction going continuing going forward, or do we see our inventory turnover ratios coming to 1 or below 1 or something of that sort? If you could give some color on that.
So one thing that I would say is that there is definitely certain in content investment for our newer initiatives, which are part of which definitely would have some or the other place in the inventory that is currently being reported. But secondly, directionally, the target and thought process is to be bringing down the inventory in a steady manner.
So you said some amount of the inventory is for the new initiatives. Could you give some color on what our inventory write-off policy is for those? Is it the same as the traditional business, or is there a different policy?
It is linked to consumption. So, for example, if there is some, say, a television episode that we have licensed from a broadcaster, supposing, and, so it's for a... say 3 telecasts or 5 telecasts, but we charge it off when we have the first telecast. And but when we have acquired it, it would sit in the inventory. Supposing I acquired a show which has say 300 episodes, then content would sit in the inventory till it is consumed, and as and when it is consumed, it would get charged off.
Okay, right. And so if you, so I'm guessing that ratings have suffered because of the IPL and now the T20 World Cup. So if you could give some color on where we stand on both our channels and what we aspire to, where we aspire to reach over the next 3-4 years on an overall, percentage share of the total ad revenues or something of that sort.
See, more than IPL, the ratings have actually suffered, as we've discussed, because of the unlockdown. During the lockdown, sitting at home, the consumption of home entertainment, both on television and digital, was at its peak. During when the unlockdown has happened, the movement back to work or, whatever, outside movement has kind of brought down overall media entertainment consumption, home entertainment consumption. And that we have seen reflected even in our digital business, including the YouTube numbers. If you see for the quarter also, it's been uniformly felt across the board. So that has been a bigger impact on the overall viewership. Now, to answer your other question on, on what kind of market share and or what kind of revenue. So, all I want to say is that the addressable segment that we are, looking at. So, Marathi advertising pie on television is estimated to be between 800 to 1,000 crore. And Hindi general entertainment pie is estimated to be around 7,000 to 8,000 crores annually. So these are the two segments that we are currently operating our two channels in. And we believe that they are, large enough to offer scale at a certain scale, definitely a decent ROI on the investment.
But so even if you could give a ballpark figure that if you're looking at achieving say 2%, 3%, 5% of the total addressable market over the next 3 or 5 years.
So
if a ballpark target.
That would not be fair on me to put that kind of a number, unfortunately. But as I said, these are the two segments that we are addressing and or kind of operating in, and we believe that there is a for both the segments the opportunity size is fairly large enough. You know, the addressable pie is large enough to offer profitable scale.
Okay, and so in the traditional media.
Sorry to interrupt, Ms. Mehta. May we request that you return to the question queue? There are participants waiting for their turn.
Sure.
Thank you. The next question is on the line of Ankit from Bamboo Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. Sir, on the Shemarumi part.
Your line is in the talk mode. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. Sir, on as
from the current participant, we'll move on to the next. That is on the line of Dwanil Desai from Turtle Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, Hiren. You're able to hear me? Hello?
Dwanil, your line is in the talk mode. Please go ahead.
Hi, you're able to hear me?
Yes, we are able to hear you, sir.
Yeah. Hi, Hiren. Good afternoon.
Yeah, good afternoon.
So, Hiren, two questions. So, this, you know, on new initiatives, you know, we've been spending 15 crore. So I was expecting that, you know, since in Q2, ad spends have revived across the industry, we would have kind of at least, you know, reduced some burn on some of our broadcasting channels. But the number has remained broadly in the same range. So, how should we look at this number? Is it because that we have invested more money in something like Shemarumi? Is it because of those kind of things that the number has remained around 15 crore? Can you throw some light on that?
Yeah, yes. This is a consolidated investment which includes Shemarumi.
Okay. So, no, what I'm saying is that, so, is it fair to assume that our burn on the broadcasting channel would have come down?
I would say it's probably maybe marginally. I don't, considering also, as Kranti had earlier explained, that we have made, you know, this additional investment in the Marathi content part. So, considering that, I would say maybe it's come marginally come down, not significantly.
Okay. And second question, as an extension to that, so I mean, we are all making investment with the hope that things will, you know, play out as planned, and we have already spent 130, 140 crore on this new initiative. Now, but any kind of a plan in place as to, you know, we'll pull the plug if, you know, certain parameters, certain indicators are not met or certain investment limit is reached, because we can't be remaining in perennially in investment mode, right? So, any thoughts around the same?
Yes and no also, and the reason I'll tell you, yes, that's really how we have pulled the plug on many of our investments. So, I don't think we are married to any of our investments from that point of view. So, that is definitely bound to be the thought process, and if I would use the word discipline, you know, definitely. However, as I just said earlier also, that unfortunately we've not seen a normal time. So, what is, you know, where this thing can be placed in a normal time, only then we can put a count to say that, you know, yes, this is now, you know, playing out as we thought, or not playing out, or, you know, there's a significant gap, or what can be done. So that is the challenge that we have faced. We are hopeful that this quarter, and, you know, as this whole festive season ahead of us plays out, at least we may be at a good level compared to pre-COVID this thing. And I mean, all of us had hoped, in January or February, we were all looking forward that from April onward we should be broadly back to pre-COVID levels. But then wave two hit us, and wave two has hit many businesses much more significantly in terms of sentiment than anything else. So, you know, the fear of wave 3, etc., has made many traditional advertisers quite cautious. And second, many industries have faced supply chain issues, because of which also their advertising has come off. So we definitely know automobiles or some of these other categories have and which they are definitely large advertisers on television. So that's what I'm trying to tell you, that considering that, what we have tried to do is try to, one, gauge whether at the core the offering is being accepted. Are we gaining market share? Are we gaining mind share? Are we is the offering being accepted? Secondly, are we overall, so therefore the first question is, are we in the consideration set of the audience or not? The second question really to think is that, how do we minimize or leverage, reduce the overall investment in the interim to a level which is more sustainable, or at least more conducive kind of a level. And third, of course, we've also tried to ensure that it doesn't cause a balance sheet strain. So if you see the overall balance sheet, our debt level, we have kind of maintained it broadly at where we were, and therefore and while meeting all our obligations, financial commitments, etc. So at a broad level, it kind of shows the strength of the underlying cash flows of the rest of the business. So these are some of the things, because the opportunity size is such that we have to give this, particularly the broadcast business, we have, and we also know for a fact that the broadcast business has a certain gestation period. So the opportunity size and the fact that there is a higher gestation period, I think it needs to be given its fair chance to bloom, and then examine whether one approach is whether to pull the plug, other approach is how do we make it profitable or at least break even, because the business gives significant other advantages in terms of the brand connect and things like that.
Okay. My second question is, with respect to syndication business. So I think, in the earlier calls also, we have indicated that we may continue syndication business, but may not want to grow, or at least a incremental capital may not get allocated to syndication business in a significant manner. So, compared to where we were in FY19, FY20, where do we see our syndication business stabilizing? In the current quarter, whatever growth that we have come, we have got from 20 crore to 76 crore QOQ, is significant part of that coming from syndication? Can you help me understand that?
Sure. So you are absolutely right in the understanding that, and this is something again we have discussed in the past, that the capital allocation for us is focused much more on B2C versus B2B, and syndication in the syndication business there are two parts to that. One is the trading part of the business, and then there is the syndication of existing content library, etc. So that anyway continues, because those are the rights we own, and we monetize it across all media, including the television media. But the trading part, consciously we have reduced the overall capital allocation there. You know, and to that extent, you know, it will definitely, you know, over a period, not now, but I mean, again, we are in abnormal times, but if we were to stabilize, you know, where we were, say, by 18, 19, we would be at a lower, you know, at a lower share of that to the overall business pie. And the third aspect to that was about this quarter. Yes, in this quarter, definitely there has been a, and we have mentioned it also in the in our earnings release, or I spoke about it in the opening comments also, that yes, there has been a certain cautious revival of demand from the broadcasters, and to that extent, there is a certain contribution of that, you know, in fact, I would say a large contribution of that to the this quarter's top line.
Okay. Thank you. I'll come back in the queue.
Yeah. Okay.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rishikesh Oza from Robo Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. Very good afternoon. So my first question is if you could share the loss split for all our initiatives, and broadly if you could share when can we leave these losses?
I just said it at the beginning of the call, but I'll just repeat it. The overall investment for this quarter 15 crores, and for the half year it was 32.5 crores.
Okay, so we're actually looking for loss split for all our initiatives.
Sorry?
Loss split, a split of losses for our initiatives.
Split is,
yes.
So, yeah, split is not possible to give at this point in time. And we've not shared the split overall. And yeah, the other question, what was the other question?
So my other question was broadly if you could share when can we leave this losses for this initiative.
So, you know, as I shared in one of the earlier questions also, we had estimated, for example, for the Marathi channel to break even in a certain time frame. But, you know, given what we saw on the COVID front, you know, and COVID has an impact on viewership as well as on advertising. So it's not one thing, it affects both. So, you know, given all of that, you know, we've the timeline obviously got an extended and our estimates proved wrong. And therefore, I would like to refrain from, you know, giving that estimate of when it would look to break even, because these, as I said, these are abnormal times. If it was normal times, we could see a certain trajectory. Like each time we saw a certain trajectory of growth, some or the other of these factors, you know, came and hit, you know, the overall numbers.
Okay, sir. My second question is on...
Sorry to interrupt, Mr. Oza. May we request you to return to the question queue? There are participants waiting for their turn.
No problem.
Thank you. The next question is on the line of Deepak Podar from Sapphire Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir, for the opportunity. So I just wanted to understand, in your opening remark, you did mention that our adjusted EBITDA for first half is about 50 crores, right?
Yeah.
So that's about 25% kind of a EBITDA margin that is on the adjusted basis. So I just wanted to understand, maybe it is because of your initiative or the expenditure in your new initiatives that is driving the difference between the reported and the adjusted EBITDA margin, right?
Yes.
So I just wanted to understand by when you see the reported margin converging to your adjusted margin.
As I just explained to the previous caller or question, that so it will ultimately happen when these initiatives break even, or, you know, are at least in a positive zone. Now, what is that time frame? You know, I am refraining from kind of estimating right now, because as I said, in my past estimates have been proven wrong, you know, by COVID. So, you know, it's very difficult right now to put that kind of a timeline, unfortunately.
Yeah, understood. But even a year or two, something on little on the broader, will
No,
that.
I mean, if I have to give a broader timeline, yeah, hopefully it should be much shorter than that.
Okay.
But it's difficult to put a, you know, to pin down right now, because each time we were in a certain trajectory and we thought that, you know, the line of kind of breaking even is visible now to us, you know, on, you know, one or two of the initiatives, something or the other. So COVID kind of came and hit, second wave hit, and now the unlocking is hitting in a different way, because the overall viewership of home entertainment has come down. So it's, as I said, we've still not, so to say, normalized.
Okay, I understood. And this quarter, our expenditure net of revenue new business was about 16 crores, right?
Yes.
Okay, that's it from me. Thank you very much. All the way best.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Ankit from Bamboo Capital. Please go ahead.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity. On the traditional media side, you know, prior to disruptions starting in FY20, in FY19, we did report close to, you know, 396 or around 400 crore of revenues from the traditional media side. Of course, over the last 2-3 years, our focus has been more on B2C. But let's say if everything normalizes and there is no more COVID third wave, so where do you see this revenue stabilizing in our overall scheme of things? I'm removing the broadcasting part from this. So let's say, you know, if we in FY19 we did not have any revenues from broadcasting. So on a broad-based comparison, let's say in FY23, let's say if things normalize, how do you see the revenues for traditional media?
See, as I explained earlier to one of the questions, I think Dhwanil had asked that question. So the focus of investment, see, the traditional media earlier model was kind of a quasi trading and investment kind of a model. Now, if I, for example, were to have allocated the capital which we allocated, say, in the new investments towards that business, then we probably would have been in that trajectory to come back to that revenue maybe by FY23, or, as you know, I don't know the timeline, but we, you know, because then you are kind of turning over the capital into the same business. But given the fact that we, you know, have consciously decided to do the B2C investment in the newer initiatives, B2C business focus, the capital allocation has kind of been allocated more towards these newer B2C initiatives. And to that extent, there will be a gap in the cap. So since there is a gap on the investment side of the traditional model, it would result in a relatively lower this thing. The whole idea is that, you know, how do we move from a business which is more B2B, more trading oriented, and more, a little more lumpy, towards a business which is far more stable, predictable, brand-led, consumer connected, and therefore much more you know, much more sustainable kind of a thing. That's the effort that we are, that's the journey that we have embarked on, and we moved a significant way on that journey. And yeah, I mean, we believe it's a matter of time before that kind of you know, materializes, or that manifests. And to that extent, what I would say is that, you know, one cannot, you know, so while we may compare where this business will go versus where it was, but it wouldn't be fair to say or expect, given the change in the whole strategy and approach. And therefore, you know, what we are doing is replacing that with a significantly more sustainable and, you know, in a regular kind of more predictable business. So that's really the effort. Yeah, Kranti,
yeah. In fact, I'd like to say that, you know, last few quarters, I mean, I would say we've not had the traditional media, you know, syndication deals, and yet, you know, the revenue, sustainable revenue lines that we had been building, already building, have sustained the company through this time also, and funded some of the new initiatives. So
bulk of the new initiatives.
So hence, you know, the company is moving towards, as Hiren said, a more predictable, sustainable business. Also, you know, a B2B deal, we figured that a dependency on few buyers was becoming very large. And, you know, the value unlocking in actually, you know, being a B2C brand and getting the value out of the consumer can be a lot, lot more. Yeah. And we're already experiencing it, which has actually kept the company going, you know, in the last few quarters.
So on this, you know, the trading part of the traditional business, of the syndication business, you know, do you think over the past 2-3 years there has been a significant impact of OTTs coming in, which have impacted the viewership of the movies that we, you know, syndicate to the TV channels?
TV viewership is not down, and what has impacted is advertising, fallen advertising because of COVID, definitely. And even before COVID hit, if you remember, India was going through a lean period and broadcasters were already, you know, seeing drop in advertising at that point, and then COVID happened. So what has led to the drop in buying from broadcasters is the advertising revenue drop. So viewership, if you can check independently, and viewership on television has not suffered.
But is it that the viewership on TV movie channels has suffered? Do we have some data on that? I think I don't have that one.
Question?
No, the viewership on the TV movie channels has suffered significantly post the pickup of OTTs.
No, that data is freely available. You can BARC data is freely available. You can go and verify it.
Sure. And my second question was,
interrupt, Mr. Ankit. So may we request that you return to the question queue? There are participants waiting for their turn.
Sure. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Rohit Trivedi, a private investor. Please go ahead.
Hi, good afternoon, Hiren and Kranti. Hope you can hear me.
Yeah.
Yes.
Great. Thank you. So my first question is about Shimarumi. So bulk of the investment that we are making would be on the part of our TV channels and Shimarumi. For TV channels, we have got a benchmark data about the profitability and return on equity kind of right from other players. So we can hopefully, keeping the fingers crossed, expect that over a period of time, we will kind of right trend towards the same line. Right. But on the part of the OTT, that is Shimarumi, even bigger players than us kind of right, who are well-funded, who are well-capitalized, are also making huge losses, right? And those losses are sustained still. I know we are in a niche category. We are a differentiated player. We are looking for kind of right a specific regional kind of right segments, so on and so forth. But still, could you give me some colors around what is our thought process around Shimarumi in terms of finance, not in terms of the right content part of it, in finance? How much are we putting kind of right roughly, let's say, of new initiative into Shimarumi? What is the trend line that we see in terms of subscriptions over there, and when, right, hopefully we can see the profitability or kind of right turning around on the part of the Shimarumi? Thank you.
Okay. I'll just try and address it in a couple of different ways. This is a very, very early days in the OTT journey, the OTT businesses journey. And to that extent, this is a phase where investment is called for and probably going to be required for a certain amount of time in terms of building the technology, the brand, and the content. All the three parts that, and of course, the overall user experience and things like that. You know, I agree that, you know, a lot of people have been spending a huge amount of money. We have, in fact, been extremely cautious about, firstly, you know, kind of deciding when to do the B2C rollout. It was only when we saw certain trends of consumers paying, etc., or, you know, starting to pay and, you know, all those kind of things was when we actually embarked on the B2C strategy. Till that extent, we were more B2B to C. Secondly, you know, we have attempted to, and till now at least, we've been fairly successful, I would say, in keeping the overall cost structure of the entire thing relatively much, much lower compared to many of the other players. And when I'm saying cost structure, it is, you know, technology is a large, very large cost. We've kind of attempted to keep it as low relatively as possible. Considering the fact that we are a, you know, a regional player, we cannot afford to have the technology cost go out of hand, you know. And third is the content part. Now, content, of course, is, you know, depends on, you know, the market situation as well as, you know, various other things. In fact, that is exactly one of the reasons why we have refrained from sharing some of the numbers till now. Obviously, one is it's too early days, but more importantly, it will impact the economics as well as the competitive scenario significantly if we, you know, put out numbers, because this is a time when, you know, all and sundry are trying to enter this space. And if they have, if we share numbers, if people know numbers, you know, the we'll suddenly see a large flow of fresh offerings in this space. So we really have, you know, tried to maintain the leadership position and, you know, reach a place where we kind of become the de facto player in this. Now, you know, these are some of the aspects or thought process as far as the Shimarumi Gujarati offering is concerned. We started from a very strong position of having a great right to win. Our team has successfully added some great new content, created or commissioned great content, which has been very well received and I would say loved by our consumers. But I would say that, you know, the journey of this OTT business is still, you know, just the beginning. This is probably the first or second step in a 1,000-mile journey. You know, if we rewind back, for example, say 20 or 25 years back, when, say, television was at this stage, you know, at that time also, the television's journey kind of played out in a certain way. Initial period was a period of investment, funding, brand building, consumer connect, content, etc. But once that, you know, business crossed a certain scale, you know, the players who kind of grew with it, or, you know, they all kind of did great. So that's really the larger, bigger picture that we are kind of looking at.
Thank you. My second question, Hiren, is kind of right, very quickly around.
Samir, may we request that you return to the question queue? There are participants waiting for their turn. Thank you. The next question is on the line of Harsh Beria, an individual investor. Please go ahead.
Hi, I have a question about average weekly viewership in the Marathi channel. I think you guys started at over 100,000 views. What would that number be currently for Marathi Bana and also for the Hindi TV channel?
I'll have to come back to you, Harsh, on this number, because each week the number gets reported. I don't have the exact.
If you can reach out to
our, you know, IR team, they will be able to help you with that.
Yeah, I will. And just to follow up, do you provide segmental breakup currently as to how much of the conventional revenues come from these two endeavors, like Hindi TV and Marathi TV channels?
No, what we are currently, in fact, something that we have been, the split two different data points that we have been providing. One is a split between traditional media and digital media businesses. And second is the investment, in new initiatives in that respective quarter.
Okay, that's it from my side. Thank you.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Viraj Mehta from Equirus PMS. Please go ahead.
No, thank you. My question has been answered.
Thank you. The next question is from the line of Shikha Mehta from Equity Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. I just had a couple of follow-up questions.
Yeah.
So if you could tell us what your ideal inventory turnover would be, what your aim is over the next 2-3 years.
Well, I can, short of giving you any figure, what I would like to obviously say is that we'll have both the levers playing out over the next, if I have to look at the next 2-3 years, our target would be to play out both the levers, which is a lower inventory and a higher turnover. So, so to that extent, the inventory days would change significantly. Also, as we discussed, that some of the newer, inventory related to some of the newer initiatives have a shorter cycle also of consumption. So that ultimately should lead to a lowering of the days or a increasing of the turnover, whichever way you want to look at it.
And so broadly on our traditional media revenue, or our inventory, whichever is preferable, could you give a breakup as to how much we use for our own consumption and how much we use for trade currently?
Very difficult because, if I have to put it in a different way, wherever we have the digital rights, for example, so if I have the, digital rights, we monetize it or distribute it or consume it in some or the other format, whether it's YouTube or, some of the other OTTs or telco or Shimarumi. Since we have multiple touch points and distribution endpoints available or consumption points available, we kind of optimize or look to optimize on that. And similarly, if it's traditional, then either we would have syndicated it to a TV channel, or right now we on Hindi we movies we are, since we are running a general entertainment channel, we don't have movie programming slot by and large for that. So we don't consume any Hindi movies for Shimaru TV, but Marathi of course is a movie channel, so there is inventory or our content is being consumed for our in-house purposes.
And on an average,
Ms. Mehta, may we request that you return?
Just a small question, it's my last question, if you could just let me ask it. What would our margins be broadly on the traditional media?
Sorry, but I'm not in a position to give you the breakup.
Okay, but we're still maintaining the 18% IRR, right?
That is really the guiding part overall. That's what we've been, saying and driving at. So that IRR to us is far more important overall, compared to the margin front.
All right. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. The next question is on the line of Dhwanil Desai from Total Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, guys. Thanks for allowing me to follow up question.
Hiren and Kranti, can you share some thoughts on the content strategy for both Shimaru TV and Marathi Vana? Because when I look at the channel, when I view the channel, so in Shimaru Marathi Vana, I see certain effort to kind of dub the Hindi movies and show them. And I think probably we are also showing Bahubali in a dubbed manner. And on Shimaru TV, other than Jhoom and Jazbaat, I hardly see any original content. So how do you guys think about it? And what is the game plan there?
Yeah, so Marathi, you are right. We have been dubbing some of the movies from our existing library, and as well as we have acquired certain Indian language films for dubbing into Marathi, and that's something that has kind of just been started a few weeks back, and we have more content lined up because there is a logistical issue of dubbing, censoring, and then so it takes its own certain timeline of putting out a film. Yeah, Kranti.
Yeah, so Dhwanil, see, to run a movie channel, you need a certain amount of content. And while when we started, we had a strong library to sustain us, but because of COVID and theaters being shut, the release pipeline of new films really dried up for us. So we innovated and we said, why don't we bring in blockbusters from the South whose production quality, content level is, etc., is superlative. And it's proven that it works in Hindi. We also did a lot of research about how the audiences in Maharashtra view that content, even though it's in Hindi. And we felt that it could work. And hence we have, tried to, use this as an innovative strategy. And we felt it could be a good differentiator also for us. Also, some of the library movies from our own library, we've tried to dub. And, few of the movies which you may have seen Hindi dub are Shimaru library movies, which we can, the content is lying with us. We have to just dub it and put it out there. So we thought it was worth, refreshing the channel with this kind of content where there is blockbuster content being delivered in the language which is preferred by the region. And I'm happy that you've seen the Bahubali promos, and, we would have actually ideally spoken about it in the next call because it's being done in this quarter. But the creative effort behind making it, a superlative product has been great. I mean, really, really, really a lot of effort has been invested. And maybe we'll speak about it in greater detail in the quarter. On STV, I will say that initially when we launched the content, the entire strategy was led by acquired content. And we decided to produce our first show, Jhoom and Jazbaat. But following that, basically, we were hit by wave 2, the COVID wave 2, and we saw that the advertising revenues were looking difficult, and therefore we...
Plus shooting was
Yeah,
halted.
And shooting also was halted. So and given that, we put a pause on that strategy. In the meantime, some other insights that we gained and research that we did, we've done a lot of even consumer level research on Shimaru TV now. And we've now divided the day part. If you see, there's a very clear day part-wise strategy that we have evolved, led by our own Shimaru Bhakti slot. There's a kids slot after that. We are trying to evolve a crime slot in the middle and then the prime time. Some of the acquired content is working well for us, and we are definitely exploring creation. The thing with acquired content is that we get proven content with a proven track record already. So
and at a relatively far lower cost per episode at this point in time.
Yeah. But that being said, we'll definitely look at, production with the right concept.
Ultimately, we would be looking at creating more shows or creating shows and, taking it to that next level. But this is, only once we reach a certain level, and as well as the ad revenue itself also reaches a certain level. So but thankfully, as I said in the beginning, on the positive side, our ratings actually are probably at a, I believe last 2 weeks we are at a high in the year, for the entire year. So we've actually, you know, some of the, at least some of the initiatives that we've taken or programming changes, etc., have actually resonated well with our audiences, and you know, that's kind of giving us a lot of confidence on the STV front.
Yeah. Swanil, I also want to add that on Marathi Bana, we've done a lot of ground level B2B work in terms of, you know, during the whole B2C work on ground, BTL activities. So during the whole Ashadi Ekadashi Vithal festival, we've done a very extensive, you know, like maybe 15 to 20 centers wide activity on ground. And then during the Ganesh festival, again, we have done. So, you know, connecting the brand at the very grassroots level has also been a continuous focus for us.
Just a follow-up, if I can.
Sorry to interrupt, sure. But Mr. Desai, may we request that you return to the question queue?
Sure, I will.
Thank you. The next question is on the line of Rishikesh Oza from Robo Capital. Please go ahead.
Hi, sir. So my question is, if you could share your margins on YouTube that you want.
Rishikesh, I'm sorry, we're not in a position to do that. Normally, due to competitive reasons, because, you know, it impacts many different ways on, particularly on the content acquisition side when we have to put out. So, sorry about that.
Okay. And also, sir, second question regarding, you know, purchase of library or the contents. So, in a longer term, can the business sustain with around 50 to 100 crores of purchase?
I'm not able to understand the question. I can just elaborate a little bit more. We'll try and address.
So basically, the content or the library that we are purchasing, we might have to keep updating our libraries. Okay, and we might have to show some new content and some new episode series, etc., etc. So on a longer term, you know, whether our business can sustain, you know, with just around 50 or 100 crores of purchases?
That's a relative question for two reasons. One is, firstly, 50 to 100 crores is not the purchase that we do. We do significantly more than that.
Correct.
In any of the past years that if you see, it's significantly higher than that.
Right.
But more importantly, we will, you know, follow in terms of, you know, capital, it will go towards the B2C initiative significantly more. So whatever is the demand or need of that respective business to, you know, that is being invested in, that is what will go. And therefore, it's, you know, we don't look at it that way to say that, oh, 50 to 100 crores we will invest. We will invest what is needed for that business to reach certain metrics that we are looking forward.
Okay. Just last question from my side, sir. So basically, just wanted to know, you know, our burn rate stop loss for OTT. If you see all, you know, and also if you could share your underlying assumption for starting OTT, because all players are bleeding. You know, our content production house has like 1-250 crores and still bleeding, and they still have no visibility as such. So if you could share these two points over here.
So I'm not in a, I mean, so while we have our business plan for the Gujarati so two aspects to that. Firstly, let's understand what is the overall opportunity that we are addressing. So Gujarat is essentially, broadly speaking, three markets that get addressed. One is the Gujarat resident audience. Second is Bombay. And third is the international audiences, because there are two to three pockets of fairly large Gujarati speaking audience. And in fact, some of, you know, couple of those territories are highly high ARPU or high paying territories, US, UK. So if we were to map all of this, firstly, Gujarati happens to have about approximately 5 to 6% of India's population is a Gujarati speaking population. So that is in a way the addressable market. Now with that, if you break it up to internet penetration and things like that, you arrive at what is the video this thing. And then where we are today in terms of SVOD offtake is obviously significantly low, but in a period where the consumer zone affinity towards SVOD has been growing year on year in a significant over a period of time, that as you kind of play out that number, kind of look at a quite a decent kind of number. So that's really how the assumptions have kind of been built out. Now to answer your other question on what is the stop loss, or what is that?
One big stop loss, yes.
So, while we have budgeted for it, I'm right now unfortunately not in a position to share that with you, because it can cause different kind of tremors or different kind of assumptions, amongst our competitors or other industry participants.
Okay, sir.
But one thing I would say, as I said earlier also, is that we have overall been extremely mindful of the cost factor. You can look at numbers across and you will understand that what we are spending is a fraction of what anyone would spend. And therefore, our idea also, we understand that this is a much longer game, the whole idea is to to finish first, you have to first finish. And to do that, how much can create a sustainable kind of a situation in terms of cash flow or this thing, so that, because we all know that when this plays out and when this grows, that number can be humongous. And at that point, the delta that you get on that, in terms of because your rest of the costs are broadly the same, it's the delta impact that you can get is can be significant. So
Rishikesh, I'd also like to add that what we are also doing is actually strengthening the exploitation of the Gujarati content overall. So apart from Shemaru Me also, we're building other revenue models for that same content. We have some DTH services running. We have a YouTube where we put derivatives of the content up, and looking at some other kind of monetization also for that same content. So that, again, as Hiren said, that it can be more sustainable. And the entire load does not only fall on Shemaru Me.
Okay, no problem. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. A reminder to the participants, anyone wishing to ask a question may please press star and one. As there are no further questions, I now hand the conference over to Mr. Hiren Gada from Shemaru Entertainment Limited for his closing comments.
So thank you everyone for joining us today on our Q2 FY22 earnings call, and we hope to see you all back next quarter. Thank you everyone. Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of Shimaru Entertainment Limited, that concludes this conference call. We thank you for joining us, and you may now disconnect your lines. Thank you.